Today is 15th September, the day on which Mottakunda Visvesvaraya was born. He was born on September 15th, 1860. He was a Titan. He was a Titan. He was an engineer, administrator, and a statesman of rare type. His brilliance and vision have given us monuments of beauty and utility, such as Krishnadas Sagar Dam, Mysore University, Bhadravati Iron and Steel Works in Karnataka, and so many other things like Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore. Let us see a few of his achievements and why he was noted. Why he was called Bharat Ratna. His entire philosophy of life was one word: work. Work, disciplined work, and efficient work. Character and efficiency in the long run lead to high working capacity, comfortable living, and longevity. This is clear from the life of Mottakunda Visvesvaraya. He led a life of honesty and purity. He did not in any way take advantage of his position for personal benefit. He never misused his official position. It is really a life worthy of being emulated. Now let us see something about his birth and other things. He was born on 15th September, as I told you, in a village in the Agrahara, Mottakundam, Agrahara, Siddanur village, Karnool district. His father was Srinivas Sastri, mother was Venkat Lakshmamma. In the same year, incidentally, Motilal Nehru, Madan Mohan Malaviya and Rabindranath Tagore were also born. Srinivas Sastri, the father of MB, died when he was 15 years old, when MB was 15 years old. Visvesvaraya was taken to Bangalore by his maternal uncle and got him educated. After finishing his high school studies, he continued his education by working as a private tutor and by earning some money. After finishing his course in engineering, he joined Bombay government service. MB used to go to the worksite riding on a horse. One of his contributions was supply of drinking water to Aden, which was then under Bombay government during British regime. In recognition of his valuable services, he was given Kaiser Hind Medal. Another achievement of Mottakunda Visvesvaraya was that of repairing the water tank of Kolhapur. Kolhapur is a famous place where Mahalakshmi temple is there. There was a big tank, source of drinking water, and it was full of mud. And once it happened that a portion of the tank was breached. On behalf of the king of Kolhapur, Kolhal Fairness sent an urgent message to Bombay government requesting for an experienced European engineer to be sent to take up the repair work of the tank. The government had enough of European engineers, but it deputed Mottakunda Visvesvaraya for the purpose. Mottakunda Visvesvaraya visited Kolhapur 3 or 4 times to supervise the work and got it done. Such contribution made MV very popular. Most important contributions of MV were construction of dams across Musi River, thus preventing floods in Hyderabad. His contributions to Mysore state were all well known, and some of the incidents will be, let us discuss some of the incidents. He was famous for his invention of automatic gates to prevent floods in Pune and other places in Bombay state. He was very particular of spreading knowledge and practical training. There was no need for university qualified men to go and search in jobs. he went to Japan and saw how Japanese people worked there. And for the first time, special grants were made for the education of depressed communities when he was Diwan of Mysore. The school-going population of these communities was proportionately very low, so he was the first to introduce a grant of scholarships to those students. He had introduced compulsory education in the state, which later was embodied as a fundamental right in the Constitution of Independent India. The goal aimed at was to double the school-going age in 5 years, school-going children population in 5 years. People were first astonished at the sight of girls going to school during his time. Society was not in favor of this idea, but now girls' education received special attention. In the course of 5 years, the number of girls attending schools was doubled. The Maharani's College of Mysore was raised as first grade college with a Bachelor of Arts course in 1917. The first hostel for women students was opened in Mysore in 1917. The number of educated in cities is proportionally high. Out of this, the number of women was 5 in 100 only. They were only literate. Their educational qualification was limited. Till then, technical, commercial and social education were receiving very little attention, and he took very special interest in promoting all these things. Though 75% of our population was dependent on agriculture, very little attempt has been made to teach agriculture as a science. Visvesvaraya was responsible for starting agricultural schools and experimental farms in the state. An agricultural school was opened in Hebbal near Bangalore in 1913 with a large farm attached to practical work. The ryots should know the use of the latest scientific agricultural improvement tools and scientific area of engineering. Agriculturists were short-term courses for ryots were introduced. Agriculturists were conducted experimental farms on government cost. Mechanical training institutions were founded in district quarters. For the convenience of those engaged in trade and commerce, evening classes were organized in bookkeeping, banking and geography. Thus, he was responsible to start a college and then start a university. Professor Kattamanchi Ramalinga Reddy was the principal of Maharaja's College, and he was deputed to university in England, America, Japan, Canada, Australia to make suitable recommendations to government. Thus, Mysore University was started in the year 1916. So, Visvesvaraya's contributions in all fields was very exemplary. Visvesvaraya had given a detailed picture of his conception of village. He does not use the word model village, but he wanted a self-respecting village, a village that would feel proud of being self-contained and not depending on others. At least 10% of the population should be at school. Being unable to pay for a watchman to look after their cattle, they used to send their children for this purpose. To work in the fields to remove the weeds, women were appointed. This he prevented by giving adult education centers when all the women were sent to adult education centers. This was the achievement of Visvesvaraya during his Diwanship in starting self-respecting village. He wanted that every village there should be one carpenter, one blacksmith and one cobbler. Ancillaries such as cartwheel, footwear should be made in the village itself. Every family should have some subsidiary occupation. There should be one minor or subsidiary industry practiced in village of 250 villagers. Every family should store at least 2 years' supply of food grains. That was his idea of village. Debt should not be incurred except for productive purposes. Thus, it was his dream and he made it possible. And he made it possible. Farming does not imply solely physical labor. Agriculture is a science by itself. By scientific methods, produce could be increased fourfold. Those engaged in agriculture would have learned this by experience. Yesterday was never tired of repeating that no country could become rich by sticking on to agriculture only. He evinced keen interest in the development of subsidiary operations. The maximum quantity of silk in India is produced in Mysore. The services of Signer, Washington Mack, an experienced Italian expert, were secured for improving sericulture. A central sericulture farm was opened at Channapatnam to provide disease-free cocoons. To grow better quality of mulberry and cocoons became the special function of the farm. The services of Davison, an expert in livestock, were procured, and he was entrusted with the work of dairy farming, cattle and sheep breeding. Two villages near Bangalore were selected for this purpose. From Australia, Dumbra and Merino sheep were imported to breed better type of sheep. The climate of Bangalore was found specially suitable for fruit and vegetable gardening. Kemmer Krumbigeler, an expert from Germany, was made in charge of this program. The Lal Bagh, which in essence was built in Tipu Sultan's time, is noted for its spacious garden. It is haven of retired people. Lal Bagh Botanical Gardens in Bangalore and for the beauty of the garden of Mysore. He is responsible for introducing better quality of beetroot, cabbage, grapes, pomegranate and other varieties. A story is told which illustrates his honesty and rectitude. Once, after inspection of a village, a dinner was provided in the traveler's bungalow to Visveshwara and his team. A menu giving the cost of various courses served was found on the table. He went through the list, took out 10 rupee note and placed it on the table, saying that it was to meet the dinner expenses of his secretary and himself, as he did not like to tax the poor people of that area, poor rural people. All remonstration proved futile of the villagers. The minister who had accompanied him was not in the habit of making payment for the hospitality he received, since the rural people were treating him as their guest. He was obliged to pay. That was the way in which Visveshwaraya behaved with the villagers. Our people are quite intelligent and not inferior to any others. That was his firm belief, and he trained the villagers like that. Mysore is famous for its sandalwood. The highest percentage of sandalwood trees grow in forests of Mysore. They are monopoly of the state. Its fragrance has spread all over the world. Mysore sandal soap has earned a worldwide reputation. Our people know the uses of sandalwood, but not the process of extracting oil from it. Prior to 1916, sandalwood was being auctioned and the purchasers used to export it to distant countries like France, Italy, Germany, where it was treated to yield sandal oil, the base for various perfumes and toilet preparations. The oil used to be re-exported to India for consumption in this country. Visveshwaraya wanted to stop this and this exploitation. The process of extracting oil was a trade secret, and never the manufacturers gave their solution. Trade secret, and the manufacturers were reluctant to part with it. Under the advice of Visveshwaraya, Indian Institute of Science conducted experiments and succeeded in extracting oil from sandalwood. This eventually led to the establishment of sandal oil factory in 1916 with a capital of 7 lakhs. Later on, Garlapur Shastri was sent to foreign countries to learn the latest process of manufacturing soap, the possibility of utilizing non-edible oil was explored and was found a success. State-aided factories were started at Tirthanhalli, Mysore and Chennapatna. Thus, Mysore Sandal soap started coming into the market. Mysore was not only famous for its sandalwood, but also for the exquisite carvings in sandalwood. So, that was how sandalwood industry was developed during Visveswaraya's regime. Visveswaraya was very particular and used to advise people not to succumb to the feeling that fate is conspiring against them, and to give the feeling, that we are being tossed about helplessly in this samsara sagara by the invincible, inexorable law of karma, which has ordained the present and future. He was of the view that Indians were concerning themselves too much with the other world, neglecting the present. He was dead against this wastage of food, wastage of time, wastage of everything, wastage of resources, and waste of health. Thus, he wanted all the people to be very active and involve themselves in the construction of society. Untouchability is not prevalent among other countries except as it is among Hindus. So, he inaugurated the first Mysore Civic and Social Conference in 1937. He drew pointed attention to the caste system, which in his word is responsible for great many of our disabilities, and has left an appreciable portion of the population in a state of permanent degradation. He suggested measures for the amelioration of deprived classes, curtailing the expenses on account of marriages, funerals and other religious ceremonies, preparing public opinion for raising the marriageable age, promoting social intercourse and harmony between various communities, promoting indigenous methods of physical culture and temperance, investigating further social legislation. So, he advocated certain customs in our marriage system. Scriptures advocate marriage of Hindu girls at the age of 8. Our marriage customs, he pointed out, are also a hindrance. Every early marriages are responsible for much avoidable mortality and among the infants and every year, and restriction of marriage within a limited circle can only result in feeble progeny. Thus, he discouraged certain types of marriages among the relatives. He was very particular that our holy temples should be kept tidy. He insisted that every pilgrim should wash his feet at the entrance, wipe his feet dry with a towel before entering the portals of temples. Receptacles should be kept to throw plantain skins, coconut shells and other unwanted material into them. He was in favor of legislation against beggary. That was his social attitude. And Visveswaraya was a firm believer in the democratic system of government. He always consulted many people whenever he wanted to take up a reform. Visveswaraya, in 1922, when Delhi was the new capital was under construction, the government of India appointed a committee which had for its objective the formulation of a sound scheme for construction of Viceroy's residence, central government offices, assembly buildings, etc. The committee was presided over by Sir Malcolm Hayley, and Visveswaraya was one of its members. The committee inquired into the financial aspects of construction of the new capital, inspected the buildings, checked up plans and tendered suitable advice. Thus, Visveswaraya was associated with so many things. He was responsible for getting the Indian Institute of Science into existence. He was Visvesvaraya would never give up his constitutional walk. He was fond of going long across, going on long country walks. He was by birth poor, by tradition gentleman, by bringing and self-controlled, and by nature a virtuoso. Always helpful, he had no enemies. By occupation an engineer, by circumstances a divan, mentally a scientist, by efforts an industrious. He had the courage of conviction and strength of mind to act accordingly. Success in life depends on action. That is what you do and not what you feel or think. And the price of success is hard work. He exemplified it in his life. He remained healthy to serve the nation. He attained greatness by dint of hard work. Visvesvaraya enjoyed great power and influence for over half century. During this long period, there had never been slightest whisper against him on the misuse of power or personal ends or helping friends or relatives, which is not common in this country. Which is not uncommon in this country. He was an exception to this practice. To claim relationship was a disqualification, he used to say. On the eve of his becoming a divan, he invited his relatives to a dinner. Speaking to them after dinner, he made it clear that he would accept the high office on the condition that none of them would approach him for seeking appointments or other favors. That was his life, and Visvesvaraya's life was a lesson to the modern generation. Guru Ramaswamy Iyengar, Sahitya Academy Award winner, was on tour in America with his wife during 1977-78. He went to see the dam named strangely as Hungry Horse. The security officer there, he was past 70 years of age, asked, "Is Sir Visvesvaraya, the chief engineer, still alive?" Guru replied that only recently he had passed away at the age of 102 years. "Oh," he said, "he was a grand old man, a giant among engineers. When he came here, all the chief engineers of America assembled to hear him. He examined the construction closely for more than an hour and gave a very valuable suggestion." The fame of Visvesvaraya had crossed the oceans, and he was well known even in America. So Visvesvaraya was no ordinary man. He was an all-rounder. He was, in fact, a Viswarupa.